If you're into self-hosting, one common piece of advice you've probably heard is to avoid exposing your self-hosted services to the public internet and instead to use something like Tailscale or WireGuard to access your services instead. This is generally good advice because it pretty much reduces the risk of self-hosting down to almost zero. But exposing your self-hosted services to the internet does enable you to do some pretty cool things that you couldn't do otherwise. For example, I have certain apps like Jellyfin for TV shows and movies, and Send for file sharing that I need to share with family members who need to be able to just open the service up in a browser and can't be expected to deal with things like Tailscale or WireGuard on their devices. Another example is Plausible, a Google Analytics alternative I use, which obviously can only collect data if it's exposed to the internet. Aside from that, apps like Tailscale and WireGuard need to use the VPN functionality on your phone or laptop to run, which is a problem because I already have a regular commercial VPN running on my devices all the time. So I do expose my self-hosted setup to the internet, and I've been doing so for years with absolutely no problems. So far at least. Hopefully I haven't just jinxed it. So in this video, I'm going to go over some of the ways in which you can keep your self-hosted infrastructure secure when it's exposed to the internet. Now, keep in mind that this is not a tutorial, and it's not an introduction to self-hosting on the internet. I'm not going to go over the basics of setting up a server, forwarding ports, connecting a domain name, setting up HTTPS for those web services, or anything like that. I assume you've already done all of those things, and my focus will be on further steps that you can take to protect your setup. If you are interested in a more basic self-hosting 101 kind of video, let me know in the comments. Now, let's talk about protecting ourselves from bots. You see, the vast majority of the risk that comes from exposing your services publicly is not that they will be breached by some guy, you know, in a hoodie sitting in a dark room in Langley or something, but that it will instead be breached by a bot, an automated process that's just randomly finding machines on the internet and hitting them with anything it can. Things like common login credentials and known security exploits, just hoping to find some vulnerable machine that it can take advantage of and do things like install ransomware, look for valuable crypto wallets or other files, create a DDoS botnet, etc. So there are two levels of protection when it comes to defending yourself from these kinds of bot attacks. The first one is obvious, and you're probably doing it already. You need to make sure that you keep all your software up to date so that you have all the latest security patches and are therefore protected from the common exploits that the bots will try to use. So make sure that everything, from your operating system packages, to the firmware on your server, to the firmware on your router, to the apps themselves, are updated regularly. You should set up automatic updates wherever possible, as long as you know it won't break anything. I use Watchtower to do this in my Docker Compose-based setup. Of course, all software has undiscovered zero-day vulnerabilities that will not be covered by security patches because of their nature, but those are very valuable, so they're not used in random, untargeted bot attacks. And besides, I know you, you're not important enough to waste a targeted zero-day attack on anyways. The second level of protecting yourself from bots involves banning any IP addresses that look like they might be a malicious bot, based on things like a lot of failed login attempts, their location, and other kinds of suspicious behavior. When it comes to SSH, assuming you've exposed your SSH port to the internet, adding this second layer of protection is very straightforward. Just install a package called fail to ban. This is like one of the de facto universal standard things to do when it comes to securing SSH. And you don't even need to configure it, because the out-of-the-box configuration is usually fine. From the moment you install it, any IP that repeatedly tries and fails to log in via SSH will get banned for a certain period of time. Since we're talking about SSH, I'll also mention the other de facto standard things to do, which are to disable root login via SSH and disable password-based login and use key-based authentication instead. So that was SSH. When it comes to your web services themselves, the fail-to-ban equivalent is a piece of software called CrowdSec. CrowdSec will watch your HTTP traffic and ban any IP that looks like it's scanning your machine for common vulnerabilities, or repeatedly trying to log in to one of your apps with the wrong credentials. But it goes a step further beyond that. CrowdSec connects to a crowdsourced database of IP addresses that are known to be malicious, and it automatically blocks those for you as well. So by using CrowdSec, you're both taking advantage of and contributing back to this crowdsourced database. Keep in mind that setting up CrowdSec is a bit complicated, And obviously, the specifics of how you do it will depend on the exact software you use in your setup. For example, I'm using the traffic reverse proxy to expose my services, so I needed to install and configure the CrowdSec middleware for traffic. Again, this video is not a tutorial, I'm only going over the security improvements you can make on a high level. In general though, the documentation for CrowdSec is pretty good, but if you are interested in a detailed walkthrough, you know where to let me know. The next thing you can do to cut down on bot-based attacks is to simply block access from specific countries that you don't need your apps to be accessible from. For example, I only need my Jellyfin service to be available here in my country, as well as to family back home. So I just block access to the rest of the world. This way, even if there is some huge security vulnerability in Jellyfin itself, bots coming from most parts of the world would never get a chance to exploit that vulnerability. Again, the exact implementation will depend on your setup. If you're using the traffic proxy like I am, then there's a plugin called Geoblock that you can use for this, and it works pretty well. Speaking of vulnerabilities in web apps, most of your self-hosted apps are probably going to have some kind of authentication where you need to log in to use the service. Now, you have to remember that the people who develop software have to concern themselves with a lot of different things other than authentication. Take Jellyfin, for example. I'm sure the developers are experts when it comes to things like video processing and media management, but they have had some security issues with authentication in the past. So instead of relying on each app you host to protect itself, it's better to have a single unified authentication layer that covers all of your apps, and this is commonly known as single sign-on or SSO. Dedicated SSO software is developed by people who are focused on authentication and don't have anything else to distract them. This kind of software also gives you things like two-factor authentication, alerts, role-based access control, the ability to sign in with other services, etc. It's also more convenient since you only need to log in once for everything, although it could also be less convenient depending on how you integrate it, because in some cases you may end up with two layers of authentication. Either way, it's great for security. Popular open source authentication solutions for self-hosters include Authentic with a K and Authelia, which is the one I use. Speaking of authentication, here's an extreme measure that I take for specific apps that I consider very sensitive. It's called Mutual TLS or mTLS. Basically, when you connect to a website over HTTPS, that website presents a certificate to your browser to prove that the website is genuine. mTLS basically means doing the same thing, but in the opposite direction. Your browser also has to send a client certificate to the website. So in addition to the normal username and password that you provide to the app itself, mTLS adds another layer of authentication on the transport level. Obviously, this is not convenient because you will need to install a secret certificate file on every device you own, but it is something you can do for apps that you want to access remotely, but that still need a very high level of protection. Okay, so those were a few things that you can do to prevent bad actors from getting into your infrastructure. But what if they do end up getting in? How could you tell that that has happened? This is where monitoring and alerting comes in. You need to make sure that you're collecting logs and other information about what's going on in your system, and that you have a reliable means to be alerted when unexpected things happen. Now, there are a lot of different things that you can monitor, and different pieces of software that you can use to do so, so I'll describe my own setup to give you some ideas. All my alerting is done through a service called Notify, that's NTFY. This is a service that allows you to set up push notifications that are sent to your phone or web browser. It works really well, and it has an API. So with a bit of programming knowledge, you can set up notifications for pretty much anything imaginable, and some apps even support it natively. For example, I use an app called Uptime Kuma, which sends me a notification whenever any of my services goes down for any reason. Similarly, I have webhook alerts set up in Jellyfin to alert me whenever someone logs into the app. I also wrote a custom script called Logtify, which monitors logs from Authelia and CrowdSec to notify me whenever someone logs in or whenever a suspicious IP gets banned. I should mention that the Notify developers do have a free hosted version of their software at notify.sh that you can use, but you can also, of course, host it yourself. Aside from that, I use Prometheus and Grafana to give me statistics about general traffic and performance patterns on my services, and I use Bestzo to monitor things like the CPU, RAM, storage, and temperature of my server, and it alerts me if those things cross specific thresholds. You get the idea. Use monitoring and alerts to make sure that you're aware of all important events happening on your system so that you can take immediate action if something unexpected happens. Speaking of unexpected things happening, another very useful way to monitor for a security breach is to use a honeypot. A honeypot is a fake service that looks like it might contain something valuable to a hacker, like a file server, for example, that might make for a good ransomware target. In reality, it's just there to alert you if someone ever does try to access it. You can run a honeypot on your local network, not exposed to the internet, so that if it ever does get accessed, you'll know that something is wrong and you can investigate further. The one I use is called Open Canary. It's fairly simple to set up, and you can choose to get alerts in a few different ways, including via webhooks for Notify, which is what I use. The last thing I want to talk about is not a specific security measure, but a concept that you should apply everywhere, called the principle of least privilege. This basically means locking things down as much as possible, except where you have a good reason to do otherwise. For example, I run Jellyfin in a Docker container. By the way, because it's 2025, I assume you're also running everything in containers. My Jellyfin container needs access to the folder where I keep legally obtained TV shows and movies, but not to the folder containing legally obtained music. So I make sure to only mount the one specific TV and movies folder instead of the broader parent media folder. Here's another example involving exposed ports. Obviously, port 443 on my server is exposed to the internet because that's what HTTPS uses, and I also expose port 22 for SSH as well. But I also have an MQTT service that's used for smart home devices, and it's running on port 8883. Now, I could expose port 8883 to the internet, and things would probably be okay, but I have no need to do that because it's just not required outside of my home network. And in the worst case scenario, I could end up with strangers controlling my light switches. So I just don't expose the port because there's really no good reason to do so. These are very small things, but it's good to develop a habit of being critical of your setup and applying the principle of least privilege wherever you can, because you never know when it will save you. So let's tie this all together. If you set up everything that I've described in this video, your self-hosted infrastructure is now pretty resistant to all the random bot-based mass infiltration attempts that public-facing services have to deal with. Obviously, there is always some risk when it comes to these kinds of things. There's always a chance that your setup still has some vulnerability that could be exploited. So you do still have to carefully consider what you put out there. At the end of the day, there's no one-size-fits-all solution. And of course, there are always ways to go even further with security than I have. For example, you can isolate things even more using virtual machines or multiple different servers with network segmentation, but I couldn't tell you about any of those things since I haven't done them. Anyways, I hope this video helped you on your self-hosting journey, and as always, if you want to see more random Linux and software crap from me in the future, you know what to do.